Hello everyone and welcome back. So I hope you have liked the content presented so far as part of this NPTEL course on powder metallurgy. So right now we are in the final stage of the powder metallurgy process, that is sintering, and with regard to that we have been discussing about the different techniques which are used for sintering the powder compact. In the past couple of classes, we have been discussing about this full density processing. And in the previous class, we have talked about different techniques which are used for full density processing. And these processes, which are called hot consolidation processes, basically apply the pressure and the heat simultaneously, and therefore kind of combine the compaction and sintering operation in one step, unlike the conventional sintering process in which the powder is first compacted and then the compact is sintered separately. Okay, so with regard to this hot consolidation processes, we have taken up some of the techniques which are used in the previous class. We discussed about the hot pressing method, then we talked about hot isostatic pressing, and we also covered the powder forging operation. Okay, so in this class we are going to continue and learn about some more methods of full density processing. So today let us start with one more process of hot consolidation. This is powder extrusion, which is done at elevated temperature to achieve full density. Okay, if you remember, we have talked about powder extrusion during the discussion about the shaping operation, and powder extrusion is one of them, but it was done just to, you know, shape the powder using a slurry, right? So there was no question of any heat in that case. It was simply to compact the powder into a particular shape, right? But here we are talking about densification with the simultaneous application of heat and pressure. So the powder extrusion process that we are going to talk about right now is the one which is done at high temperatures. So here, if you look at the process as to how it is carried out, the powder is first canned in a vacuum tight container, and then it is degassed and finally subjected to hot extrusion, right? So this is what you see, you know, this is the powder which is canned into a container, right? And this is loaded into the extrusion die, okay? And then you have a small penetrator which directly pressurizes the powder. So this is what you can see over here, you know, with the help of this penetrator, the pressure is applied on the powder as it is being heated up. And this kind of application of pressure through a penetrator will also make sure that the buckling of the container is prevented. The other end of the extrusion die has an opening, the size of which depends on the final diameter of the rod which is needed. So as the powder is pressed through this penetrator ram, it gets densified and then comes out from this opening as a solid rod. And pre-alloyed powders are commonly used here, you know, for making the product. And the geometry that you obtain at the end of this process is basically long shape with constant cross-sectional area. So that's the main product which comes out of powder extrusion process, this kind of long geometries. The extrusion force is given by an equation like this. Where C is a constant, which is a measure of the deformation and the flow resistance of the powder. A is the cross-sectional area and R is the reduction ratio, which is given by the ratio of the billet area to the product area, that is the ratio of the area before the extrusion and after the extrusion. Here the temperature is the main controlling factor. Too high a temperature would cause damage to the microstructure and hence the properties. And on the other hand, if the temperature is low, then it makes the extrusion process difficult because high stresses are involved in the process. High temperature can also affect the tool life and, you know, shorten the tool life. And therefore, in this process, the temperature has to be properly controlled. The application of this process is to make, you know, product out of different metals like copper, aluminium, and also alloys like nickel-based alloys. And it can also be used to make composites because a second phase can be mixed with the powder and can be consolidated along with the powder to give rise to a composite. And there is another type of alloy, you know, which are basically high temperature alloys known as oxide dispersion strengthened alloys, or ODS in short. Which basically contains oxide particles as dispersion, and these particles provide strength at higher temperatures. Okay, so these are alloys which can be used at high temperature applications, and this powder extrusion is an attractive process for making such alloys. So this was all about the powder extrusion process. All right. So far, the processes of full density that we have seen are all by through hot consolidation, wherein the heat and pressure are applied simultaneously, right? But there are also some cold methods of full density processing in which there is no need to apply the heat simultaneously, and a density close to 100% can be achieved even without that. Okay, and powder rolling is one such process. So this is how the setup of powder rolling looks like. So here, a loose powder is gravity fed in the gap between two rolls, which generate a strip or a sheet. Okay. So these are the shaping rolls that you have over here. Which generate the green sheet or strip. The powder is fed through this hopper. And once the green sheet is made, it is sintered to further densify it. So here you have the sintering furnace. And then it is further rolled to fully densify it. Okay. So since there is no application of heat in the beginning while the powder is being shaped, it has to be sintered, you know, to achieve a 100% density. And it is also re-rolled, you know, to make sure that the end product which comes out is a 100% dense product. Okay, so this is the finished product which comes out after this process, and this can be in the form of a sheet or a strip. The main challenges in this technique are the slipping and cracking of the feed material, right? Because here a loose mass of powder is fed through these rolls, right? So although sometimes a binder is mixed, but still there are chances that, you know, this shaping will be a challenge here, because the powder can slip through these rolls, or even if it is shaped into this kind of sheet or strip, there are chances of cracking. Okay, so that is one of the major challenges in this process. And the other limitation, of course, is with regard to the product form. Here only a sheet or strip can be made, as you could see over here. But nevertheless, this is a process which can generate high densities even in cold conditions without the application of simultaneous heat during the shaping process. Okay. Now we are going to talk about a technique which is very effective in achieving full density in a wide range of powders, starting from metal to ceramic to composites and whatnot. Because there, the mechanism of densification is quite different, in the sense the heating mechanism itself is very different, right? And vacuum is also applied so that the problem of trapped gas, which limits the densification, is not there. So this is the process, you know, that we are going to talk about right now. And the process goes by the name spark plasma sintering. Okay, so why it is called spark plasma sintering, I'll come to that in a moment. But as I was saying, here the heating mechanism is quite different from what we have seen so far. Okay, so in all the processes of sintering that we have discussed so far, the heating is done by keeping the powder compact inside a furnace, and heating of the compact as such takes place by conduction, right? And this kind of heating sometimes leads to problem in terms of achieving uniform temperature across the compact, or we have also seen before that, you know, it can also give rise to some differences that you need to first estimate, and accordingly you will have to set the temperature. Okay, so if you remember, we had talked about this temperature setting for conventional sintering processes where the heating is done by conduction. So here, as I said, you know, the powder compact is kept inside a furnace, and the furnace is heated up, and the heat is then conducted to the compact, right? So you can always expect a difference between the furnace temperature and the actual compact temperature, and this difference delta T has to be estimated if you want to achieve the temperature in the compact which is actually needed, right? So therefore, in these cases, this delta T has to be estimated a priori, and the temperature has to be set accordingly, and the sintering time also has to be set based upon this temperature after it is calculated by considering the delta T, or the difference of temperature between the furnace and the compact. So in order to avoid, you know, these kind of issues with regard to the heating of the compact, this spark plasma sintering process that we are going to talk about now applies a different kind of heating. Okay, so here the heat is generated internally in the compact instead of conduction through the furnace, right? And this process is also known as pulse electric current sintering, PECS, or field assisted sintering technique, or FAST. Okay, so these are the other names of the process, and All these names arise from the fact that the heating method is through the application of an electric current. Okay. So that is how it is heated up internally through the Joule heating mechanism, where you apply an electric current and that gives rise to heating. So this is the heating effect of electric current which is used here, and that kind of heating is known as Joule heating, as you might already know. Okay. So here the heating is localized, that means it happens particle to particle inside the compact as the electric field is applied. I'll come to the detail of the process in a moment. And therefore, the distribution of the heat is uniform, and this also allows rapid heating and cooling. And therefore, if you want to make materials where a fine grain structure is needed, that means if you want to avoid grain growth, this would be the process of choice, right? Because here the heating and cooling takes place very fast, so there is no chance for the grains to grow during the heating or the cooling operation. And even the sintering time which is needed in this case is much lower compared to conventional sintering, simply because of the fact that the heating process here is much effective as it is done internally in the compact, right? So that also ensures that the grain growth is limited, and therefore a fine grain structure will be generated in the final sintered product. Right, so as I said, the process cycle is much faster here. It is in minutes compared to hours or days in case of the conventional sintering process. So therefore, it is suitable for making nanocrystalline or ultra-fine grained materials where you need to preserve the small grains, okay? You need to prevent their growth. So let us see some details of the process. There are various mechanisms proposed for this SPS process, but the most accepted one is as follows. A microspark discharge is generated in the gap between the powder particles when an electric field is applied, and that is what leads to the heating. Okay. And as far as the sintering process is concerned, here also there are three stages, but the phenomena which happens during each of these stages is quite different. In the first stage, plasma heating takes place. This is nothing but the electrical discharge between the particles, resulting in localized and momentary heating of the particles to high temperatures, right? So instead of conduction heating through the compact, which happens slowly and depends on the conductivity of material, here the heat is generated by this electrical discharge from particles to particle contacts, right? And therefore, on a localized scale, if you see, the heat is quite intense, right? Because it is only through the contacts between the particles, and therefore the sintering temperature can be achieved very fast in a very short period of time. The micro arc is uniform, so the heating is also uniform because, as I said, it is set up between the particles to particles, and since in the compact there are particles all around, so you can expect it will happen uniformly, and therefore the heating is also expected to happen uniformly. The particle surface is purified due to the evaporation of the impurities due to the high localized temperatures. So this is another advantage of the process. As the spark is set up between the particles, it generates a very high localized temperatures, as I said, and due to that, whatever impurities are adsorbed on the particle surface will simply evaporate, and you will have a fresh particle surface for the bonding to occur during the sintering process, right? So this is again another beneficial effect that this spark heating provides for better densification to occur. Right, so as I said, the purified surface layers of the particles will fuse to each other, forming the necks, and the densification will start as the necks grow. So this is all about heating through the Joule heating effect, as I said before. So here a DC pulse is applied, which flows from particle to particle through the necks, and that results in the Joule heating, which is uniform across the compact, because as I said, it happens from particle to particle. And this heating also results in enhanced diffusion and neck growth, and therefore the densification process is quite fast compared to the conventional sintering process. And during this heating, here also, you know, there is simultaneous application of pressure, because we are talking about the hot consolidation processes right now. So this is also one of those. So apart from the heating, here you have simultaneous application of pressure as well. So that leads to plastic deformation, and that is the third stage. Once the heating is achieved and the compact is heated up uniformly through this Joule heating, the plastic deformation will begin as the pressure is applied. So due to this heating, the material becomes softer, and the applied pressure causes plastic deformation, and this plastic flow and the faster diffusion will result in 100% densification, right? So for most of the materials, you can achieve this 100% densification in a much shorter period compared to the conventional sintering process. So here is a schematic which shows the heating mechanism of the SPS process. So here an electrical current is used to create that Joule heating effect, and as the current is applied, this plasma discharge is set up in the gap between the particles, as you can see from these arrows over here, the red arrows, and that leads to the Joule heating, which uniformly takes place across all the particles, right? So Joule heating, as you may know, is the heating effect of a current which occurs due to the resistance that is offered by the material to the electric current. Okay, so if I is the current flowing and R is the resistance, then the heat H will be I square R. Okay, so in order to achieve a high temperature here within a short period of time, a high amount of current is needed. So therefore the electric field in this case is applied through a DC pulse having a very high current to the tune of a few thousands of ampere. Okay, so as this amount of current flows into the material, there is intense heating due to the Joule heating effect, and you know that leads to very high localized heating of the particles. And one effect of that, which is primarily responsible for the faster densification which takes place in this case, is the fact that this leads to surface cleaning, okay? Because the particles have to bond through the contacts at the surface as the neck forms, right? So therefore, when you have a clean, fresh surface, the bonding between the particles will be enhanced, and therefore the densification will also be improved, and a faster densification will take place, right? So that is what this Joule heating effect does. in terms of achieving a better particle to particle bonding and therefore an enhanced densification. Right, so that was about the basics of this SPS process. There are few more details about the process as to how it is carried out and, you know, what are the different phenomena and densification mechanisms occurring. We need to discuss all those, but we'll take up probably in the next class. So for today, before we wind up, let us take a moment to summarize this class. Today we talked about some more of full density processing. One was the powder extrusion, in which the powder is extruded at high temperature. So here the powder is, you know, loaded in a die and it is being pressed with the help of a ram. And as it is pressed at high temperature, the powder is densified, and from the other end, which is having this opening, it comes out as a rod. Okay, so the main products of this powder extrusion process are basically the long products having constant cross-sectional area. Okay, and here we have seen that the temperature is the main controlling factor which will control the process, and different kinds of materials including metal alloys and some specialty materials like these ODS alloys can be processed by this powder extrusion method. Okay, then we talked about a very unique technique called spark plasma sintering, which is quite different from all the other sintering methods that we have talked about so far, right? Because in this case, the heating which is taking place to heat the compact and, you know, densify it is very different from the conventional heating processes that we have for the other methods that we talked about, right? So here a high amount of current in the form of a DC pulse is applied to generate the heating in the compact through a Joule's heating kind of effect, right? And that is what we have discussed in this class today as to how it happens. Right, and this is a schematic which we discussed to understand this Joule setting process. So a very high current to the tune of a few thousands of ampere is applied in the form of DC pulses, which leads to intense localized heating. And this intense heating actually leads to cleaning and purification of the particle surface, resulting in better bonding between the particles, and as a result of that, the densification process is enhanced in this particular technique. And with that, we come to the end of this particular class, but I do hope to see you soon again. Thank you for watching.